What drove you to get into the race and to be a candidate?
Yeah, I'm running for president of the United States because I believe that our country is facing some big challenges. And having stepped up to the plate in many tough challenges in public service, I know that these challenges and these problems aren't going to solve themselves. It requires leadership. And I am the only candidate out of the three running for the Democratic nomination for president that can point to 15 years of executive service actually bringing people together to get important things done, whether it was stepping up at to turn around what had become the most violent and abandoned and drug-addicted city in America, whether it was leading my state through the recession and making her stronger along the way by making college more affordable, our schools number one, and the U.S. Chamber of Commerce naming us number one for innovation and entrepreneurship. I know how to get things done, and I don't put a finger to the wind or confuse following a poll with following your principle. I'm about, that's not me, and I believe that what our country needs right now is a leader who will be truthful about the challenges we face, who will not declare that all Republicans are our enemy because they're of a different party, and who instead will focus on the things that create common ground and that unite us as a people. At home, we passed many, many difficult things. Some of them we only were able to get done because of a few Republican votes. I'm thinking of repealing the death penalty, something we did in our state. I'm thinking of marriage equality. But whether it was those issues or passing the DREAM Act or raising the minimum wage, as an executive, you learn you have to call everybody in the legislature all the time. You never know what combination is going to be required for the consensus necessary to move forward. So I run because there's a growing injustice in our country, and injustice doesn't solve itself, and it threatens to tear us apart as a nation. We need to remember who we are, and we need to create an economy so our children all can get ahead when they work hard. This should be a country for all of us, not just for a few of us.
Polls, of course, suggest you have a huge uphill fight on your hands. Your numbers are not good. I mean, I don't need to tell you what your numbers are. What is your strategy moving forward to catch up to Hillary, basically, is what we're talking about. The latest poll in Iowa earlier this week, Monmouth poll, showed her at 65, you at 5. What's your strategy here and elsewhere to catch up and overtake her?
Yeah, I intend to campaign the Iowa way. I intend to go county to county to county. I'm not in a very different place than many other challengers that we had never heard of before until caucus night, who then beat expectations. And in our party especially, there is a gravitational pull towards the new leader, to the candidate that's speaking to where our country's going rather than to where our country has been. I think that both of our parties are actually looking for a new leader. And while in the early on, people gravitated to those candidates that were the lightning rods that repudiated the established leadership in both parties, I believe that now the search is on for the new leader. So it took a long time for us to have debates in my party, I'm not proud to say. By this time, 8 years ago, we had had 9 debates. So our race only got off to its start, really, 8 days ago. And I am now seeing oxygen on our little flame that we hadn't had for the first 120 days in this thing. Usually candidates wait to drop out of the race until the voters have cast their vote, and then the winnowing process begins. But in our party, the winnowing process has already begun. In the next debates, there will only be 3 of us on that stage. And as the Iowa JJ shows, we have now turned the corner from the introductory phase of the campaign to compare and contrast. And the contrast is going to become very clear and apparent. Senator Sanders and Secretary Clinton both have had 40-some years of experience in Washington, but neither of them can really point to getting much done. I, on the other hand, have been an executive. I've gotten things done. And that's what our country is looking for right now. The two phrases, Mike, that I hear everywhere I go, not just in Iowa, not just in New Hampshire, but all over the country, are the phrases new leadership and getting things done. I think some of the other contrasts that will become apparent is that I'm very clear about my principles. I know where I stand. I didn't flip-flop on the Trans-Pacific Partnership. I was against it a year ago. I didn't flip-flop on the Keystone. I was against it a year ago. And I have the independence and the backbone to stand up to Wall Street and to actually rein in the sort of reckless behavior that threatens to crash our economy again if it's unchecked. I don't believe Secretary Clinton has that independence. As she said herself on that stage the other night, I represent Wall Street. And indeed she has. And she's given lots of well-paid speeches to some of the big mega banks that she says don't need to be reduced in size and don't need to be broken up by reinstating a modern Glass-Steagall. I've put forward the ideas and the plans that serve our national interest. I am not the candidate of the big banks. I'm not the candidate of big oil. I'm running for the people, and I intend to, and I believe that people are going to respond, especially now that we're down to just three candidates.
So those poll numbers don't intimidate you?
No. Let me share a story with you. When I ran for mayor of Baltimore in 1999, a majority African-American city, we only had 88 days to go till the race. One of my opponents, who was African-American, had 90% name rec. My other opponent from the east side of town had 80% name rec. And I started as a minority mayor in a majority African-American city as the whopping first choice of 7% of my neighbors. But by the end of that 88 days, I had won every single council district, all six of them, including the districts of my two African-American opponents, and garnered 54% of the vote. So I've always been drawn to tough fights. I kind of like the tough fights. I think the toughness of the fight shows us we're fighting for something worth saving. There's a lot of people that would look, as I say to people, and as when I get up on the chair and give the talk across Iowa, there's a lot of people that would look at you and tell you your odds of giving your kids and grandkids a better future in our country facing tough odds. But I'll never bet against the United States, and I like the tough fight. And I think people respond to the vulnerability of truthful leadership that's honest about our problems.
You jumped to my next question, which was Hillary, the candidate, versus you, the candidate, and what some of your criticisms of her would be and why you think you are a better choice for the nominee. And you started down that road a bit. If you wanted to expound on that, that was going to be my next question. Included in that question was, at one of the debates, Bernie Sanders said Americans are sick and tired of hearing about Hillary's emails. Do you share that viewpoint? Do you think the emails are something Americans are sick and tired of, or is that a real issue of importance?
I think it's both. I think people are sick and tired of hearing about it to the exclusion of other issues, like how am I going to send my kid to college? What sort of retirement am I going to have? Are these guys going to try to cut my Social Security benefits, or am I actually going to be able to retire? I think that's true. But I don't think it's true that the issue is behind us. I don't think it's behind her. That'll be something that she and her lawyers and the FBI are going to have to resolve. And the FBI works under its own timetable. I think, when we, in a very undemocratic way, when the chair of the Democratic Party limited the number of debates we have and postponed the start of our debate season, I think it did make people, all we ever heard about as Democrats was Hillary Clinton's email scandals, and was, as a party, that put us in danger of being branded by that rather than the ideas that we had to offer to move our country forward and allow people to get ahead.
Can I ask about Donald Trump's approach to campaigning? I mean, what do you make of that? Because people are enamored with the idea that he calls people out. But is that really a way to campaign? Is that a way to get through to these people? Or what is that? What do you make of his technique?
I believe that what he has tapped into and what Senator Sanders has tapped into is a great deal of fear and anger and frustration about the fact that for the first time this side of World War II, 70% of us are earning the same or less than we were 12 years ago. And we hear our elected leaders say our economy's recovered, our economy's recovering, our country's doing better. And while all of those things are true, it's not true that we are all, as families or as individuals, doing better. And that makes people very, very angry. So you combine that also in Donald Trump's case, that it becomes easy in times of scarcity or times of when people are fearful about what tomorrow holds for their kids, it becomes very easy to scapegoat or blame the other, people not like us. And so that's part of the, I think, very dangerous mix he's put together. It's not just his brashness, not just the entertainment value of taking The Apprentice national and telling all of his Republican co-competitors that they're fired. What I find really, really distasteful and appalling is the racist comments that he makes about immigrants and new Americans and whole groups of people in our country. And that, I all of us have a responsibility, I think, to push back against. But as I indicated earlier, I mean, putting on my pundit hat, we never nominate fear and anger. Neither party ends up nominating fear and anger. Now, of course, none of us has a crystal ball. I don't know what the future holds. If I did, all of this wouldn't be so exciting. But typically, we don't nominate fear or anger in either party. We nominate someone that can lead our country, that can actually govern. And that's what people are looking for. I don't think that this current phase means that we've lost our capacity to govern ourselves or evaluate the merits of candidates based on what they can actually do, what they can build, what they can lead, what sort of consensus they can form. So I think that's why you're seeing him drop a little bit. And one truth remains, that the polls in October here in Iowa rarely have bear any resemblance to what happens on caucus night on February 1st.
You talked about, in answer to the question, wages, and on your website and among your goals is to reduce the wage gap in America. And I'm wondering, how does a president increase the net worth of Americans, and why is raising the minimum wage a good idea? And being a devil's advocate, should we even have a minimum wage? Isn't that a private sector-driven concept?
Yeah,
how much to pay people?
Yeah, let's talk about this. One of the very clear differences between between all of the Republican candidates for president and my own, and what I offer by way of economic theory, is my candidacy is economics and the economic choices. I think for 30 years, here's my take. For 30 years, I believe we have followed a theory of economics that says that we should remove regulation from everywhere we can, including discarding wage and labor policies. We should change our tax code in order to concentrate wealth as much as we can in the hands of the very few, so that eventually the clouds burst and opportunity rains down thanks to free markets on the rest of us. And part of that has involved the unspoken goal of keeping wages low in order to make us more competitive, though that's rarely ever given voice to. It's something that's said between the lines, though, when you make it harder for people to join labor unions, when you fail to, as our parents and grandparents of both parties did, keep the minimum wage above the poverty line, when you stop paying overtime pay for overtime work. All of those things are things that have been discarded for the most part over the last 30 years that I believe need to be restored. And so if I reduce it to three, I think we need to restore wage and labor policies back to our array of economic choices. We need to make the investments in our own country that allows our nation to create generational wealth. Nations don't create wealth by locking cash in a closet. They do it by investing in things that last and give and serve for generations, like the skills of our people, making college debt-free again in our nation, investing in our infrastructure, investing in innovation and the broader distribution of human solutions to human problems. And finally, we need to square our shoulders to the great challenge of our time and make it our opportunity. And I'm talking about climate change and moving to 100% clean, green, electric energy grid and creating 5 million new jobs, at least, along the way. And you all have already shown the way forward. Now that 30% of your electricity comes from wind, you've also created 4,000 jobs and you see the big component parts rumbling down the highway that are too damn big for it to make any sense to import them from China. So you actually have to produce them here. So all of those things are about creating an economy and recognizing the truth that if 70% of our economic activity and growth comes from consumer demand, we can't be scratching our heads and wonder why there's not greater demand when we allow wages to flatline or decline for 70% of us. And that's what's happened over the last 12 years. So collective bargaining helped to keep wages going up for all of us. When we make it harder for people to join unions, that contributes to that flatline. When we don't invest in our country, conversely, if we take the actions to include more of our people more fully in our economic life, it will make our economy grow. So I differ with those other guys essentially in this. I believe that the cause of economic growth in American capitalism is a stronger and growing middle class. I don't believe that our economy is money. I believe our economy is people. It is all of our people. And I believe that concentrating wealth in the hands of the few, as we have now done in our nation in ways that we haven't seen since the Gilded Age, actually robs our country of needed investments in our common good and prevents us from having an economy like our parents and grandparents had, where whatever income level you start at, you're able to get ahead by working hard.
I don't remember your position on minimum wage. What do you like to see done with that on the federal level?
Yeah, I am in favor of raising the minimum wage to $15 an hour, however we can, wherever we can. And in the long litany of things that I've actually done that Senator Sanders and Secretary Clinton can only talk about doing, I've actually raised the minimum wage in my own state. In 2007, we became the first state to pass a living wage. But before I left office, we raised it, and I got it to $10.10 an hour throughout our state. But we were able to encourage, and two counties, in fact, did, and through their county councils, raise the minimum wage to $12.80 an hour. I think you'll see a lot of cities get there before our federal government does. And I think in the course of their choices, what you'll see is that their economies do better and not worse. We had dire predictions that people would close the shop and close the store and relocate their business to other states. That didn't happen in our state. It's been so long since we've really adjusted the minimum wage in meaningful ways that I believe that we can and should do it, and it'll help our economy. And that's been the experience so far in Maryland.
How do you ensure then that those above the minimum wage don't just hover around the minimum wage? You know, it's one thing to say we're raising the minimum wage, but then what about if I make a little bit more than that?
Right.
And then, you know, we're all kind of in the same pot, if you will.
Yeah, you know, a gentleman said to me, you know, if you raise the minimum wage, that's going to make wages go up for everybody. And I said to him, yes, that's the intention. A woman asked me at Winterset? A woman said to me, well, look, my son went to a private college. He got the skills he needed in order to be an electrician or what have you. Raising the minimum wage isn't going to help him, and he went out of his way to train himself. I said, well, actually, it will help him. And part of the genius of our country is that we understand in every generation we have to take actions to include more of our people and the economic, social, and political life of our nation. And one of the ways we've done that with wage and labor policies is to make sure that floor always keeps moving up dependably and at least stays above the poverty line. And this was something that wasn't even a debatable economic point, you know, 40 years ago. Democrats and Republicans routinely voted to raise the minimum wage because keeping that floor there, and I think it's even more essential in a global economy. Even more essential. I mean, we sometimes get intimidated by the new phenomenon that the labor pool in our nation has doubled. I mean, in our globe, rather, in our world, has doubled in our lifetime. But increasingly, we have to remember that economies and how we build economies are very circulatory. And while it's true that the internet has brought us together and globalized our economy, there are some things that still are essential to maintain within your own footprint of this earth. And one of those is consumer demand for for the goods and the services and the products that are being built and made here. And that's particularly true when it comes to energy and food. So we're coming a little theoretical here.
Well, just to follow up philosophically on that, no concerns about too much government interference in the private sector? In other words, telling you what you have to pay, putting more regulations on you, putting more now Obamacare-related costs on you and rules on you, etc., to the point where it becomes difficult to start or to run a business in America because there's too much government.
Sure. That's always, I mean, look, you always have to have concerns about the balance, but in terms of keeping a minimum wage always above the poverty line, I don't think that's too much. And I think it's not too much for us to expect that our federal government should protect our Main Street economies from the sort of excess casino gambling that went on Wall Street that wrecked our economy before. We used to count on our federal government to have cops on the beat on Wall Street. We used to count that on the notion that FDIC meant we insured banks so there weren't runs on them. We didn't insure banks in order to bail out the bad bets of people. When they have good bets, they pocket it. When they have bad bets, the rest of us have to bail them out. That's not capitalism. That's the rigged economy that people are angry about. That'd be a pretty good game for all of us, huh? What if when you had good months as a paper, you keep the profits, and when you had bad months, taxpayers had to bail you out? That's not capitalism. That's a rigged game. So in my own state, I mean, back to the initial call of your question there, Mike, we were constantly looking for ways to streamline administrative compliance, you know, the stupidity with which governments sometimes do things in mindless ways because it's the way they've always done it. Why do I have to fill out my name and address and my phone number on the top of each page of this application? Why can't I apply to start a new business online instead of having to come and find an office someplace and wait in line to do that? So whether it was through the business portal or Maryland Made Easy, we were always looking for opportunities to streamline those things and modernize them. And so all of that is true. But at the same time, there's things that only our government can do for us. You know, policing our streets, keeping us safe, protecting the quality of our air and water. And what we've figured out a genius for as a nation is, for the most part, striking the right balance to protecting our common good, maintaining a level playing field. Until relatively recently in our history, we understood that the concentration of corporate power and monopolies were actually bad for our economy, that when packing houses are reduced from 12 to 4 in Iowa, hog farmers get lower prices. We used to understand that. We've gotten away from that. I intend, as president, one of the 15 goals I have is to restore the directive, the executive directive, to our antitrust department, our antitrust division and the Justice Department, to put fair competition back at the center of our equation. The notion that monopolies just create greater convenience and lower costs for consumers has never borne out in the history of capitalism.
Well, another part of that discussion is spending. $18 trillion in national debt. And of course, one of the criticisms of Democrats often is they just want to spend more money. And in fact, in your goals, many of those appear to me as if it would require more government spending. How do you meet the goals you want to and still tackle that national debt problem? How do we bring that debt problem down unless we stop spending so much money?
Yeah, there's no sustainable progress without fiscal responsibility. When I was mayor of Baltimore, even though we had lost an enormous amount of population, the worst population loss of any major city because we had allowed ourselves to become addicted and violent, I still maintained fiscal responsibility. And I also, during those turnaround years, also managed to bring down a competitively, or discompetitive, what's the right word, a a high property tax rate that put us at a competitive disadvantage. So I lowered property taxes. I paid our police more. And I also managed to get the bond rating agencies to actually upgrade our bond rating. As mayor, or as governor, through the recession, I defended a AAA bond rating and was one of only seven states to do so. But I also made a 37%, I brought people together to make the decisions that allowed us to increase K-12 education funding by 37% and to go 4 years in a row without a penny's increase to college tuition. How did we do that? We did it by making more cuts than any governor in modern history since the Great Depression, whether you want to measure it by dollars or percentage of budget. But we also made some adjustments and made some changes on the revenue side in order to raise more revenues. I asked all of our citizens to pay another penny on their sales tax so that we could give our kids a better education. We moved from the 42nd lowest sales tax to the 34th lowest sales tax with that one penny. But it allowed us for the first time ever in the middle of a recession to make our public schools the number one in America 5 years in a row, according to Education Week magazine. I asked our wealthiest citizens, the top 14% of us, to pay more on their income tax. But I lowered taxes on the hardest working families that were struggling at the lowest wages in our state, and I twice increased the earned income tax credit. So by the end of my tenure, the taxes that the average family were paying as a percentage, state and local, was the same at the end as it was at the beginning. But I did ask wealthier people to pay more. Let's shift to the federal government, and I'll try to be more concise here. The annual deficit is now lower than it's been at any time for the last 8 years. You can attribute that to these mindless sequester cuts. You can attribute it to the economy doing better, to President Obama's fiscal restraint. But the debt that we still have is a long-term problem that we need to reduce, because we fought a longer war on our children's credit card than has ever happened before in American history. And we didn't even pay for it as it went. So how do we bring it down? I believe that there's a huge entitlement we can no longer afford as a nation. And that is the entitlement that the very super and ultra wealthy among us feel, to pay much lower income tax rates, and not only on their income tax rates, but also on the way that the ultra wealthy accumulate and compound wealth, and that is by paying such a low rate compared to the rest of us on their capital gains, on the money that they make by investing money, sometimes in things that really don't help with the real economy and productivity, and who can blame them when there's not enough market demand from consumers because of wage stagnation. So, out of the roughly, we could raise approximately $800 billion, and our average is about a $3.1 trillion federal budget. We could raise $800 billion over a 10-year period by taxing capital gains the same as we tax income from sweat and hard work and toil, and by raising the highest marginal rates for millionaires and billionaires back up to the 45% range. Those two things together, before you get into some more kind of one-off things like a transaction tax on trades or closing the carried interest loophole, which people are talking about doing, which we should also do. But if you just did those two things, you could reduce the debt greatly and in a short period of time. When Ben Carson said there's not enough wealth to reduce the debt simply by taxing wealthier people at higher rates, actually, Ben, there are. There is. And it's called math. And it actually can be done. And for many years, we did. In fact, the highest marginal rates were much, much higher under Dwight Eisenhower, but nobody there was complaining because we had a Cold War enemy to confront. We had a country to protect. We had things that needed to be done. I think, and if we did that, we'd not only be able to make debt-free college a reality again for the vast majority of American families, for all families, as it was when I graduated college. I mean, the choices to be made, but getting through debt-free was one of those options. but we'd also be able to make the investments in technology and discovery and cures and this clean, green energy future and to make the investments in our roads and our bridges and rural broadband and those sorts of things that we do as Americans. Right now, discretionary investments, which are not a huge portion of our federal budget, are headed to be about half of what they were when I graduated from high school, not that long ago. And without those investments, it's hard to make our economy grow and go. It's all part of that ecosystem of economic progress.
May I ask about, sorry, I'm interrupting. The very wealthy have access to lobbyists. This would be just impossible to get them to be taxed at the level that you want. Because I don't know how you can turn that around when they are able to, they have the ear of the people who can make the decision.
I don't know about that. I think we're selling ourselves short by thinking we can't have this, we can't have a rational discussion about this as a people. I mean, expectations become behavior. And if you believe you can or you believe you can't, you're probably right. I believe that as a nation, we can actually have a rational discussion. When you have people like Warren Buffett saying that he shouldn't be paying a lower tax rate than his secretary, I think that's a rational statement and discussion. And I think what we have been too timid to do, is, especially as Democrats, is have the backbone to state our case and talk about what we stand for. And if we want to make debt-free college a reality, then we're going to need to pay for it. There is not a contradiction between wanting our country to be stronger, wanting our kids to have more opportunity, and wanting to be more fiscally responsible as a people. And it is a relatively small portion of our population that we would be asking to do more for their country. And when you compare that to the number of families that have paid a hell of a lot more by the number of kids that have come home in body bags from Iraq and Afghanistan in a war that we didn't even have the nerve to fund ourselves as we did it, I don't think it's a lot to ask of wealthier Americans. And you know what? I think we sell the millionaires and billionaires who happen to be Americans short when we say they don't love their country enough to want to do more for their country. I think our country is actually standing on the threshold of a new era of American progress, but we've got to shake ourselves out of this sense that we can't govern ourselves, that we can't talk with each other. That's not how our young people act. They're not in those corners.
I wanted to go back to the capital gains tax, wanting to tax it like ordinary income. Of course, you're here in Iowa. One of the largest assets of the state is our farmland. There's, of course, a number of family farmers that may have purchased their land for a certain price per acre. They retire, and it's worth quite a little more at that point. Sell an asset. Of course, that would be a capital gains. There's also a number of family businesses in the long term that those people retire, sell their assets. I know a lot of these people. I would not consider them among the wealthiest 1% of that you're talking about. Is that fair for a long term held asset like that to treat it at a higher rate than we do currently and historically?
Well, I think you have to look at the different types of capital gains, and there are many. And so there are policy choices and policy trade-offs and nuances here to all of this. And the length of time that you hold an asset and how all of that works. But what I'm talking about are the capital gains of making investments, of making money on money. That's what I'm talking about. And I don't think that there was a time back in the 80s when even a lot of Democrats thought, well, if you tax capital gains at lower rates, people will make investments in the productive economy and it'll make the economy grow. I don't think that theory has played out. I don't think there's a rational reason for taxing those sorts of capital gains at lower rates. With regard to the land and how long you hold it and those sorts of things are a different nuance of the capital gains discussion, and you're right.
One more tax question, and then I want to move on to a couple of other issues. At the risk of sounding cold-hearted, which I don't intend to be, but shouldn't everyone pay something? Shouldn't, we're talking about the wealthy people at this end, what about the people at this end? Shouldn't, there's an awful lot of Americans who don't pay any federal taxes.
Right.
Shouldn't everyone pay something? Wouldn't that help also?
Yeah, the, well, everybody does pay something. People at the wealthier end, or at the poorer end of our earning spectrum as a nation, actually pay a disproportionate amount when it comes to things like, you know, sales tax and some of those consumer sort of things. In the 40 years prior to 1980, if you looked at the number if you looked at the increase in earnings for every quintile, like from the highest 20% to the lowest 20%, during that 40-year period of time, everybody pretty much moved up about 9 to 11 steps in terms of, you know, increased income. After the 1980s, if you look at the next 40 years forward, actually what you see are people in the lowest quintile actually taking a half a step back. And you see people in the next quintile only taking maybe one step up. And the so that's the great problem we have to figure out in our country. You could put side by side a lot of the policy choices we made in those prior 40 years and the different choices we made in the next 40 years, and some of them we've talked about here, not to be redundant. But I don't believe that, or let me say it positively, the big change that we have yet to, I mean, the big change in terms of the revenue side is just this much, much lower rate that the super and ultra wealthy among us are paying, and that compounds. I mean, it's a lot easier to compound money made on money, and those are revenues that then can't be invested in our infrastructure and the other things that make our economy grow. If you asked everybody to pay a little more everywhere, you still wouldn't make up, you wouldn't restore the revenue hole that's been created by this entitlement that some feel the super wealthy among us should continue to have in terms of a lower, higher marginal rate. So that's my sense. I mentioned what I did as governor in our own state. Yeah, we all had to pay another penny, but we asked the wealthiest to pay more on their income. It's all math. There's different ways to do it.
Let me ask you about a couple of controversial hot-button issues in America today. One is you're a strong proponent of stronger gun laws. If you could talk first about what specifically as president you would support and what you think needs to be done in the area of firearms.
Sure. In my own state, after the slaughter of the innocent in Newtown, Connecticut, I put forward a comprehensive gun safety bill and made it the governor's top priority that legislative session. A lot of my pollsters, I only had one, well-meaning political consultants told me not to do it because the power of the NRA is too great, even in our state, and that we'd fail, and it would be a great political loss for me. And I told them I don't care. We bury far too many kids from, and especially kids, but we bury far too many of our citizens from gun violence. We're the only state in the nation that has a problem to the degree that we do with the numbers of people that die from guns every year, gun violence and suicides, which is why it's one of the 15 strategic goals I put out for our country. Our bill had these components. We required universal background checks and licensing to purchase new guns, with a training and safety course as part of that as well. We also banned the sale of combat assault weapons in our state, and we banned the sale of magazines with more than 10 rounds of ammunition. We also had some components in there about improving school perimeter safety and having some better standards that help schools understand what is good in security and what is not. And we also had a mental health component. I increased by 80% access to public mental health in my state during my years as governor. So we did all of those things. The NRA jammed the halls. They were the biggest crowds I saw for any issue. And we also had our own rallies and brought people together. And I chased, I had to overcome a lot of opposition in my own party. I had to chase down difficult votes to get, sometimes in the late hours of the evening, in order to get this package through. But once we got it done and had a very civil debate about it, I'm not saying there weren't times when it was really heated. In fact, the NRA wrote to all of their members in my state and falsely told them that I was trying to end hunting in Maryland, take away their right to enjoy their hunting tradition. So I pulled every permit of every hunter in our state, and I wrote to them and said, thank you for hunting. I need you to hunt. Your neighbors need you to be a hunter because your permit every year helps us conserve our open spaces. And by the way, let me tell you about the lies and falsehoods the NRA is telling you about what this legislation does and does not do. We didn't go and seize a single gun. We didn't prevent a single hunter or their kids from enjoying their hunting traditions. But we did build a consensus such that they didn't even dare to try to send it to referendum to kill it by popular vote. And so I believe that as a nation, they're kind of five components that to me seem like common sense things we should be able to get done. In fact, the public agrees right now, today, in overwhelming Democratic, Independent, and Republican numbers that we should have universal background checks. We should ban combat assault weapons. We should make the trafficking in illegal firearms a federal felony, which it is not today. There's probably greater penalties for trafficking in poached salmon than there is in trafficking in illegal firearms, many of which make their ways to our America's cities and are involved in the carnage there. I believe that we should also use our buying power, and by our I mean our federal government's buying power, it's our government, to insist on the highest and best safety technology for gun manufacturers in the United States. What am I talking about? I'm talking about the micro-stamping of the rounds as they come out of the chamber. I'm talking about serial numbers that cannot be erased or effaced that are part of the interior components of the weapons. And a fifth component I learned from the story of Sandy and Lonnie Phillips, and that is that in a bill that didn't get a whole lot of attention, the NRA managed to get Congress, including Bernie Sanders, to muscle through for them immunity from lawsuit when they or their dealers sell guns to psychopaths or murderers without following the proper procedure. And Lonnie and Sandy Phillips in Colorado, their daughter was killed in that theater in Aurora. And the man that bought those ammunition was able to do so online, 4,000 rounds, without paying a penny, without asking a single question. And when they went to court, not only was their case thrown out because of this federal immunity that gun manufacturers and their dealers have been granted, but they got slapped with $200,000 in court costs. So those are five things, five components, and I'm doing my very best to build a consensus for this sort of change in the Democratic Party. And hopefully, maybe in one of these debates, the Republican candidates will talk about their ideas for reducing the carnage in our country. 400,000 Americans, think about this, since the attacks of September 11th, 400,000 Americans have died from guns in our country. Imagine if Al-Qaeda had killed 400,000 Americans with guns in our country. What would we be doing about it? Think about that jerk with his failed shoe bomb attempt, and now we're all taking off our shoes and queuing up in long lines at the airports. And yet, what's been the change after Columbine and Aurora and Sandy Hook?
Bruce asked the question about the lobbyists for the wealthy and that tax discussion. And the same could be asked of this discussion.
Yes.
This seems, all of what you said makes sense, common sense, but it seems almost impossible. If we as a country have not gotten to the point where we can have this discussion after all of these deaths, what will it take? It seems like almost an insurmountable, impossible task. Why do you think it is so difficult, and what needs to happen to move this discussion to the next level?
Yeah, in this case, the NRA really has set up at the you know, set up at the pass, to use an old Western movie analogy. They really have set up at the pass in Congress, and we need leadership with the backbone to call them out and to take them on. One of the things I learned as an executive is that sometimes the first try isn't when you actually get it done. Sometimes it takes several attempts. But we have to be relentless, especially when so many lives are at stake. There were many things I got done in Maryland, not on the first try, not on the second try, but only the third try. It took us 3 times to get marriage equality done. I had testified for this combat assault weapons ban back in 2003 in front of our state legislature and was not successful at reinstating it. But we've got to keep going. So it's going to require a backbone and calling out the NRA.
What about a strategy of embracing the NRA and making them part of, as opposed to a us against them, what about a strategy of involving them? Is that not possible?
No, it's always...
Bring them into the discussion and make them part of the solution.
Yeah, it's always possible because... You know, just as they didn't try to take our I sometimes talk about referendum and fail to connect the dots. In our state, it's pretty easy to send a bill to popular vote up or down if it's not connected to our budget. We all figured the NRA would do that with ours. But we had, in the course of our discussion, built up such a popular amount of support for the common sense things that we did that the NRA walked away and didn't even bother to try to overturn it in our state. So you got to do 2 things at once. I think you have to build by talking about this in the context of these elections, and every election is about more than just filling one job with a person. It's about a deeper understanding. So I think we have to build up more and more popular consensus, and perhaps when the NRA sees the writing on the wall, they may become a productive part of the conversation. But if they succeeded, as long as they've succeeded, by being totally obstructionist, by being totally unreasonable, and by thinking that their lies won't be called out when they write to their mailing list and tell them, as they did in Maryland, that this bill tries to take away your hunting privileges, then they're going to keep doing what they're doing because it works. So it'd be great to have them as part of the discussion. There was a time, I'm told, not long ago when the NRA was all about gun safety and responsible gun ownership and those things. But now their goal, partly because of where their funding comes from, their goal is as many gun sales as possible. That might be their goal, but that's not what's in the best interest of the United States of America. I think that one American life is worth more than all the gun sales in America. Perhaps they can also return to the table of democracy and help us do the common sense things that increasing numbers of people believe we should do. I see young people. I see a growing consensus coming over the horizon on this. I really do. Because you look where some of these shootings have been taking place, and college campuses and the like, there's a growing feeling. Even though there's a broad swath of sort of libertarian live and let live kind of attitude among our young people on this one, I think there's a growing consensus that we've got a problem and we've got to face up to it.
The other of the two hot button issues I wanted to bring up was illegal immigration, and you support the pathway to citizenship approach. Maybe you could talk a little bit about comprehensively how you view that issue and what you think the solutions to that problem are.
Yeah, thank you. Tom Friedman, in his book, I think it was Flat Hot and Crowden, he has a formulation for what's made our country strong in every generation. And he had kind of 5 pillars. One of them is we educate our people at higher and better levels. We maintain a stable and balanced rule of law. We make the investments in our infrastructure and in R&D. And the fifth part of it was that we have a system of immigration that allows the best and the brightest from all over the world to come here to this country, that fuels our economy, that makes us so very, very innovative because of the different cultures and the different perspectives that come that our country brings forward. So I subscribe to that theory. I believe that our nation's made stronger in every generation by the arrival of new American immigrants. Most of my great-grandparents all came from someplace else. My dad's side, they were all Irish. My mom's side, they were mostly Germans, which makes me part Irish and part German, which means I like to give orders and not take them. If you look at the statistics, you see that new American immigrants are far more likely to take the risk of starting a business. You look at, you want to talk to somebody that believes very firmly that America's better days are still in front of us, that their children will enjoy the truth of the promise of the American dream, talk to new American immigrants. They believe very, very fiercely in what our country is all about. And I think that we hurt ourselves by allowing this, by our failure to enact comprehensive immigration reform so that people can actually get in a line. Telling somebody to wait 20 years is not a line. It's a sentence. So when we have failed to have a system of comprehensive immigration reform, we create in our country 11 million people in a shadow economy that are off the books. That's bad for wages. If we want wages to go up, let's get them on the books. It's also bad for our national security, especially at a time of asymmetrical warfare and the FBI looking for lone wolves and people that are in the shadows. Why do we want to create a whole shadow society in our country? So and this is another area where I disagree with Secretary Clinton and Senator Sanders, both of whom represent the sort of arguments of the past that have led to the gridlock of the present. Secretary Clinton flip-flopped on driver's licenses for new American immigrants. I never have. We passed driver's licenses for new American immigrants because I didn't think it made any sense to keep people from being able to abide by the rules of the road and get insurance when they're going to and from work to take care of their families. Senator Sanders says new American immigrants take our jobs. I don't believe that. I don't believe you ever find examples of that in American history. In fact, we wouldn't have food on our table were it not for migrant workers coming to our country and helping our agricultural economy go. So I intend to campaign on this issue because how you campaign determines how you govern. You can't claim to have a consensus or a mandate for positive change if you don't talk about what that change is. And I think the time for comprehensive immigration reform is long past. We need to put it in place. And in the meantime, I believe we need to stop these sort of mindless deportation policies that break up families. We don't make our country stronger by breaking up families. And so I intend to use executive action to cover as many as possible as we build this consensus. There's a lot of people that have been stuck in this limbo ever since Ronald Reagan did the amnesty back in 1986, and they haven't been able to go on the path of full citizenship. There's a lot of analysis that says that for the average household in America, wages will go up by $250 a year by getting 11 million of our neighbors out of the shadow economy and onto the books, get them paying into Social Security, which will expand that. And so it's what we've done, it's what our parents and grandparents did, and we need to do it too.
Is that part of your comprehensive plan for immigration?
You know, we have to have security on the border, but I don't believe it should be at the expense of due process on the border. In a final package, I think we have to be open to compromises that allow Obama's administration, that if he were tougher than any president in American history on deportation and beefing up border enforcement, that by golly, that would bring the Republican caucus to the table to achieve comprehensive immigration reform. I don't think that tactic worked in these times. Maybe it'll work in other times or with a new Congress, but if mass deportations, if for-profit detention camps, if penning up women and children behind barbed wire and chain link for months on end was going to bring about a new sense within the Republican caucus, I think that would have happened long ago. I think instead we need to be making the economic argument of why this is in the best interest of the nation's economy, why this is in the best interest of making wages go up. But I'm all for homeland security and protecting the homeland. In fact, every year, Mike, when I was mayor after the attacks of 9/11, and every year that I was governor, my Republican and Democratic colleagues in both the Conference of Mayors and the National Governors Association always, every year, year in, year out, made me one of their two co-chairs of our task force on Homeland Security. And the president appointed me to be the Democratic co-chair of the Council of Governors. So one of the best ways we could protect the border is to have comprehensive immigration reform so we're not overwhelmed with, you know, the massive numbers of people that are living in a shadow society. Then we could really focus on the problem. And the immigration, by the way, from Mexico is actually net zero now.
Say that again.
Immigration from Mexico is net zero. Like the numbers of people coming into the country versus the number of people leaving our country and going back to Mexico is net zero. And that's a separate issue from the refugee kids from Central America. It's not quite the... Donald Trump called all Mexicans... would have us all believe that all Mexicans are murderers and rapists and robbers. And he says that at a time when the net immigration from Mexico is really zero right now.
Since when? What's the time frame for that?
I think within the last couple of years. Yeah. I'll contact the Maryland State Satellite and get you the citation and get you the numbers.
I haven't heard that figure. I'm going to try to squeeze just a couple more.
Lightning round.
Kind of. Before the end of our hour.
I've got a couple in that round, so don't...
Okay, well...
I'll be short if you be short.
I'll make my lightning round then foreign policy, since we haven't talked about foreign policy yet.
Lightning round foreign policy. That's what's the matter with our foreign policy. All right. This will be a challenge.
I have three components to the question, and that's what should America's strategy be with respect to ISIS, one, Iraq and Afghanistan, two, and Vladimir Putin, three.
Okay. In 30 seconds or less.
I mean, let's make it more specific then. ISIS. Should we introduce ground troops to fight ISIS? Should we have more troops on the ground to fight ISIS?
Yeah, I'm interested in hearing what the president has to announce shortly here. I understand there's going to be additional special forces, special ops boots on the ground. I believe that what we need in terms of, we have to stay involved in the coalition to degrade, contain, and defeat ISIS. They are an apocalyptic, genocidal group, and we have to stay as part of that coalition, I believe. And while it might be attractive to think that you can do it with the push button of a bomb, this is a longer haul. And we're going to have to do a better job of interrupting their finances and interrupting their propaganda. And it's only people in the Muslim world that can really effectively interrupt that propaganda, though certainly how we act with regard to the humanitarian crisis also has an impact on that score. I think we have to stay involved. But I think we also have to be very, very cautious, because it's hard to point to an example where putting American boots on the ground actually got us the desired result over the last 15 years. Toppling a regime appears to be an easier task than building a stable and inclusive democracy. And one of the biggest mistakes of modern American foreign policy was the way that we were led into war under false pretenses in Iraq. And we have been suffering the repercussions from that, and our sons and daughters have now for 15 years. We need a comprehensive political solution in Syria, and we need to push people to the table. The Russians were actually helpful to us in getting Assad to give up his chemical weapons. Perhaps they can be helpful as part of a political solution here to at least bring about enough political stability to get us all focused on containing and degrading ISIL while we deal with the longer-term regime issues in Syria. And the other issue was the other issue was Putin.
Number two is Iraq and Afghanistan. Do we need to put troops back into those countries? We pulled them out. Do they need to go back in as those countries sort of fall back to chaos again and the Taliban in Afghanistan again?
Probably in hindsight, they're... In hindsight, we probably pulled troops too quickly out of Iraq, though all of us were, as Americans, were anxious to end our involvement there. General Patton used to have an admonition that you never want to take the same real estate twice. I myself visited your Iowa troops and Maryland troops in Tikrit, which is now under ISIL control. I think from those practicalities, our military and the president are guided accordingly in Afghanistan and slowing the withdrawal of our troops there. The challenge here is to act in coalition. We should not take upon our shoulders all of the responsibility for this. Do we have some responsibility? Yes. But other nations also want to keep, sea lanes open through the Gulf. Other nations have interests there, and we need to somehow, as a nation among nations, figure out a way in the past we used to talk about peacekeeping forces. We need to internationalize some of these responsibilities for peacemaking forces, for the ability to stabilize places, nation states after nation states have failed, because this will not be the last place that it happens, and it could even happen in our own hemisphere when you look at some of the influence of the drug trafficking in Central America and the sort of migrations that touched off. These are tough issues.
About today's announcement, would President O'Malley introduce ground troops into Syria?
I'd be very cautious to introduce American ground troops anywhere in the Middle East in greater numbers than we were already there. I don't know what the president has planned in terms of bringing in more special forces and bringing out other forces, but I think that disentanglement should be our longer-term goal here. But at the same time, we have to balance that with being part of a coalition that contains and degrades ISIL so that they cannot launch attacks on the homeland. And we have to push the Iraqis to be more inclusive in their own governing. That's what I believe.
The last part of my foreign policy question then was, and then Bruce has a couple, was Vladimir Putin. What do you think he's up to, and what would your approach be toward him if you were the president?
Yeah. Putin, I believe that Putin believes that his nation suffered greatly and lost a tremendous amount of influence after the breakup of the Soviet Union, and he believes that Western nations are encroaching and coming up on his doorstep, and he believes that his role is to restore Russian greatness, even if it involves acting badly and sending in little green men and secret armies into the Crimea. I think the international community, led by the United States, needs to make sure he pays a price for those sorts of aggressions. At the same time, we need to look for opportunities where our national interests align with Russia. Ultimately, Russia has the choice to make. Russia can be a responsible nation among nations, respect borders, respect its neighbors, or it can suffer the repercussions economically by acting poorly and by behaving badly. And we have to be willing to confront those sort of aggressions, while at the same time recognizing that the biggest price that perhaps he has to pay for Crimea is an economic price.
What have you learned from President Obama's tenure?
What have I learned from President Obama's tenure? That's an interesting question. I thought you were going to ask me how would my presidency be different than President Obama's.
He came in, though, with the same kind of energy, excitement, and he motivated a lot of young people to vote.
And I think he's done a lot of good things. And look, while Bernie Sanders was trying to get the president primaried in his reelection, I was out working very hard for the president's reelection. And I believe that he's accomplished some great things. The Affordable Care Act is a very, very positive step for our nation, an economy that's producing jobs rather than losing them for 67 months in a row is really positive work. The beginnings of what could be the planet-saving agreements with China and other large nations, I think, have a tremendous amount of promise. But no president's a magician. I mean, if there's anything we've learned from President Obama's 8 years, it's that this work requires constant tending. There's no easy button. And the other thing that we have to learn is that there's an importance to party, an importance to being strong in the party. As Democrats, we took our eyes off our state houses and our governor's races, and we're thereby saddled with a very unrepresentative House of Representatives for the next 10 years until the next redistricting because of the gerrymandered ways that governor's pens are legally allowed to draw congressional districts. And so I think one of the lessons we need to learn as a party is that we have not moved into a postpartisan world where parties don't matter. Now, parties still matter. And one of the surest ways to reach compromise with the other party is to be strong within your own. And to fail to be strong within your own allows the opposition party to engage in gridlock and obstruction in ways that aren't helpful to the health of the nation. So I think that this eagle flies best when both its left and right wings are working. And we let our wing down when we allowed our governor's offices and our state houses to get wiped out in the false belief that perhaps we had moved into a postpartisan world, personality-driven politics rather than coalitions.
My second one was what you say to a middle-class worker who thought he was on track, that he thought, you know, my life is going in a good direction, and his hours were cut, so that he's now not covered by benefits, and he has to get another job to try and help pay for everything that happens. How do you give that person hope?
What I would say is this, that our country's doing better, but we still have work to do to make this economy work for all of us. And no policy, no program, human-made, whatever came into being perfect. And we need to do better. We need to make improvements to the Affordable Care Act. We need to continue to improve our economy by making the choices that allow people to earn more as they work harder. We're not there yet as a country, and it is a growing injustice still in our nation that threatens to tear us apart. And we've seen those images. I've certainly seen them in my own city. I mean, on that awful night, I realized my country is Baltimore, and Baltimore is my country. I mean, unemployment is higher now, not only in Baltimore, but in New York, in Los Angeles, in the president's hometown of Chicago than it was 8 years ago. This sort of structural unemployment, this sort of entrenched injustice accumulated over 40 years of bad economic choices isn't going to be fixed or solved overnight, but it can be solved. Our country is doing better, and the next hill that we need to take is to make wages go up again for all Americans. The Obama administration was all about our country's economic recovery. The O'Malley administration is going to be about every family in America being able to earn more as they work hard.
We're coming up on the end of our hour, so I'll kind of come full circle here and kind of end the same way I end with whenever we hold one of these. And that is give you an opportunity to make kind of a brief stump speech, if you will. What do you say to convince Democrats, I'm the guy who is your best choice to represent the party and take the fight to the Republicans next November?
Sure. What I would say is, you want me to look here or do you want me to look there?
Always look at the camera, right? Okay.
What I would say, Mike, is this, that all across our country, people are looking for a new leader, that we understand intuitively that we can't make our children winners in this changing economy if our government isn't working and if our leaders aren't able to compromise and reach a consensus on the things that actually allow us to give our children lives with more opportunity rather than less. Chris Christie, God bless him. He can't govern very well, but he can sure entertain, and he knows a good question when he hears it. One of the questions I was asking all across the country is one that he used in one of those Republican debates. You ask people if they've enjoyed a better quality of life than their parents and grandparents, every hand goes up in a room. If you ask us as Americans whether we believe our children and grandchildren will enjoy a better quality of life, very few hands go up. We are a great people, but we face big challenges. And these challenges and these problems don't solve themselves. We need to solve them. And I am convinced that with new leadership, our country can solve them. But we won't solve them by debating the fine points or the pros and cons of socialism. We won't solve them by returning to more of the gridlocked Washington politics that Mrs. Clinton portends when she says she's proud that all Republicans are her enemies. I am not a divider. I bring people together. I've done it in some tough places over some really tough divisions of race and class and place. I would not have gotten the things done that I got done as a governor in a recession were it not for my ability to bring people together and to actually get things done, to talk with others that disagree with me, but to find a way forward. And that's what our country needs right now. And I alone, among the three candidates for president in our party, have not only the ability to do that, but I have a track record that proves I can do that. And I can do that for our country now. And I believe that the people of Iowa are going to make up their own mind. They want a candidate that's on their side, that has the courage to take on the big banks, to take on Wall Street, when necessary, to take on powerful interests like the NRA in order to get things done for our national good. I have that backbone. I have that skill. I have that ability. I have that talent. America wants new leadership, and I offer that leadership for us today, and I need your help.